Our next speaker is Michelle Delaney. Michelle is Senior Program Officer for History and Culture, Office of the Provost, Smithsonian Institution. She serves as an Associate Editor for Visual Culture with the papers of William F. Cody and is completing a History PhD at the University of Strathclyde, Glasgow. Her related book, Art and Advertising of Buffalo Bill's Wild West, will be published by the University of Oklahoma Press. Michelle this morning is speaking on Art and Advertising of Buffalo Bill's Wild West.
Thank you so much. I am so pleased to be here today. Those of you who know me know that my journey with the center and with this material has taken me over a decade of collaboration with Jeremy, Doug, Frank, and the whole papers team, and it's been some of the most productive and enjoyable years of my professional career. And anytime I can bring the West to DC and the Smithsonian, I'm happy to do it. So you all know that anyway. So this morning, I'm gonna be talking about the art and advertising in Buffalo Bill's Wild West. You'll see here in this first slide a picture from the McCracken Library, and Mary has been so important. As she mentioned in the session late yesterday, she is a vital part of all of our research as we come to the center to complete our own individual work. But this is a 1906 image from Italy, and you can see how one building and the fences would just be completely covered with the material. Buffalo Bill's Wild West differed from the history of the circus, and we just heard this from Jim, that that word, circus, is used so often, but the circus advertising was different. The Wild West, in its dedication to the artistic portrayal of the American West, continued an emphasis on the alliances with some of the most recognized artists of the period. Cody was friends with some of the American and European artists who were instrumental in advancing the appreciation and artistry of the color lithographs produced for the Wild West, in comparison, direct comparison, to the American circuses at the time. The artist's paintings and illustrations were famous well beyond the arena of the Wild West, but their involvement with it elevated the imagery and introduced their work to an even broader general public. Artists, photographers, lithographers created the dynamic and effective imagery of Buffalo Bill's Wild West. Cody and his Wild West management team developed the advertising for the yearly tours, and they nurtured the artwork of the posters. My current dissertation research interprets the impact of the printed materials advertising the Wild West, comparing it to the circus and the consumer advertising of the time, and highlighting the archival materials newly available to provide further insights into deciphering the process and the very intent of the posters and program. As an assistant editor for the papers project, the digital project, I've committed to exploring the theme of art and advertising in the Wild West and to present a cohesive visual record of Buffalo Bill Cody and his Wild West as focused through the significant collections here at the Buffalo Bill Center of the West, the Circus World Museum in Baraboo, Wisconsin, and the John and Mabel Ringling Museum of Art in Sarasota, Florida. Current online research sites for the museum collections are especially rich in the related materials, but there's never before been a comprehensive site to present this visual culture of the Wild West. And my analysis of the extant US and European posters produced for the show in these collections has located over 550 original posters and some incredible original poster art. So my research has expanded greatly in the last 10 years. I began with a focused study of one specific photographic collection at the Smithsonian, at the National Museum of American History. And many of you know I did publish a book on Gertrude Kazebier's photographs from the 1898 tour, and research now moving on to look at more of the printed materials created by, for, and about Cody and his West. There are photographs, postcards, posters, programs, the Courier and Herald, newspapers, the advertisements, and also even trade cards, buttons, and games that present the imagery for the Wild West. But it was this Kayserbeer collection that provided an excellent introduction for the exploration of the interdisciplinary study of the intersections of art and photography of the American West, the study of mass entertainment, and also Native American studies. And here we have one of Kayserbeer's image of Chief Irontail, and an image that was printed later in the show's history when it was combined with the Pawnee Bill show. And very few individual Indians were presented and named on the posters. So Chief Irontail, longtime friend of Cody, longtime performer with the show, was highlighted with this one. And I have to say, just on a sidebar, this is that poster that you see here. I was actually at was able to purchase for the Smithsonian while curator at the American History Museum. And again, anytime we can bring more of this into collections around the country, around the world, is an exciting thing. Improvements in printing technologies led to an explosion of American visual culture in the post-Civil War nation. And Buffalo Bill Cody and his team clearly understood the marketing opportunities offered them through the potential for effective use of the poster prints and the photographs to capitalize on the energy, the color, the overall excitement of the performances. As poster expert and author Jack Rennert described in a 1976 publication on 100 Wild West posters, Cody had enormous influence on the American consciousness through an arsenal of publicity produced for the Wild West. The close relationships forged by Cody and his staff with the photographers, printers, and advertising agents helped to define and produce this visual material. And it influenced the public's first impression on that fascinating spectacle. The surviving imagery of the Wild West documents how performances presented both the memory and the myth of the American West to vast audiences across the US and Europe. Cody worked with his longtime Wild West partner and Vice President Nate Salisbury, General Manager John M. Burke, which we'll hear more about in a few minutes, and General Agent Lewis E. Cook to orchestrate the elaborate and complicated logistics and promotions for the tour. And each year, the tour highlighted Buffalo Bill's own experiences, his life, those of the American Indians, and the demonstrations of expert marksmanship and horsemanship by men and women and from throughout the world as he gathered the Congress of Rough Riders of the World. Cody's Wild West was serious competition for the circuses, minstrel shows, and theatrical traveling companies of the time. Cody was a consummate entertainer who excited crowds throughout America and Europe, and his bill posters and advanced men and women negotiated the buzz or excitement and anticipation of the impending arrival of Cody in the Wild West in towns across the US and Europe with these posters and handbills. Various local photographers did document the show as it came through the various towns, but there's no evidence that a photographer was ever hired on staff. Many of the photographic postcards and personal snapshots, commercially produced stereo views, and professional portraits do still exist for study. But both the artwork and photography were used by show printers, the print lithographers, their art designers, directors, and artists who created the realistic and detailed designs. Few business records or letters of correspondence actually survived to determine the link between Cody and his team to the artist responsible for the poster work. But the branding of the show is evident through Cody's relationship with artists and the related photography. The Rough Riders and all of the performers dominated the show prints, but it was Cody, of course, each year who dominated most. We now know that at least 12 printing firms in America and Europe have been identified as making posters for the run of the Wild West. Several firms would be contracted each season depending on the designs selected and the one sheet posters or multiple posters that were of interest. And Hohen, that you see here with three of the earliest Buffalo Bill Cody focused printers, was one of the longest contracted with the Wild West. But there are four companies that I have come to focus on in my research. A. Hohen and Cohen Company from Baltimore, the Courier Photographic and Lithography Company in Buffalo, New York, the Inquirer Job Printing Company from Cincinnati, and also Strobridge Lithographers in Cincinnati. Some contemporary painters' work was reproduced for the Wild West posters from the earliest years, with limited credit given to the artist. Print historians agree that American and European lithographers did some of the best work for Buffalo Bill. His authenticity and the quality of the show reflected in the designs of the posters. As we've heard in some of the earlier presentations, Cody appreciated the best artists of his time. There was Remington, Frederick Remington, Charles Russell, Charles Schreivogel. Several poster designers could also be added, the graphic artists who were part of the teams at the different print firms. They were Matt Morgan, R. Farrington Elwell, Henry Atwell Thomas. And Cody was directly involved in all the aspects of the Wild West. And this extended to the selection of lithographers, befriending some and making plant visits for others. His general agent, Lewis E. Cook, may have been the person who had the most direct contact with the printers, and he was often under the guidance of another Wild West partner, James A. Bailey of Barnum & Bailey. The Circus World Museum holds at least one original poster sketch with the notations OKLEC for Lewis Cook. And the Ringling Museum of Art, the Tibbles Collection staff, have been assisting me in prioritizing the digitization of their holdings of correspondence between Cook and Cody, which outline their close and lasting relationship throughout the history of the Wild West and to the very end of Cody's career. We saw this yesterday in Monica's talk as well, so I won't go into some of those same aspects of femininity, but the Hoehn poster for Miss Annie Oakley accurately captured the spirit of Oakley's prowess with the gun and enhanced her feminine depiction of the real woman performer. Hoehn artists may have been provided with the Oakley photographic portrait from the personal collection of Nate Salisbury, now in the Denver Public Library. It showed Oakley in front of the scenic background in the settler's cabin often used in the performances of the Wild West. Cody, like many of his longtime performers, allowed for the general the recognition of these special skilled individual performers or groups. The posters, the postcards, the souvenir photographs publicized these stars, sharing the spotlight with Cody daily. Few American performers of the era achieved the international celebrity of Annie Oakley as she did while performing with the Wild West throughout Europe and the United States. And then I've also made reference to Remington, as other presenters have. He visited the Wild West and Cody, his friend, often, and would sketch Cody, the cowboys, the horses, also the American Indians. And the interesting thing that when I've been going through the Denver photographs is that besides Remington's work itself, these photographs were being taken potentially earlier than the Courier photographs that we'll see coming up, but that are also very, very similar to the Hoehn posters that were being produced in the late 1880s and the early 1890s. And then we begin with the important advancements that Courier took with the Wild West. With advancements in printing, lithographic firms were able to produce larger, grand multi-sheet posters and even billboard size advertising for the show. And Cody and Salisbury turned to their best newspaper contacts and close publicity advisors to advance the options for promoting the tours yearly and the special printed Courier and Herald newspapers that would also be sold to the visiting audiences. Hoehn's prolific impact on the Wild West poster art ended, and after 1895, the Wild West Company focused on many new contracts for advertising work, and two newspaper-affiliated printing firms, Courier in Buffalo and Inquirer Job Printing in Cincinnati, were in the lead. They were not, again, the only firms being used, but they became very significant between 1896 and 1908. And they often exchanged copyrighted materials for the Wild West. You'd see some of the Courier images and Inquirer images together in programs and couriers being sold. And these designs also impacted the European posters that would be printed. And here we have the very iconic I Am Coming poster that Courier produced for the 1900 tour, and this other center hit of the century, which I love from my photographic background because it looks to me like zoetrope strips, the precursor to motion picture, with all of those images in the concentric circles, and of course bringing in the larger military presence that we would see in the Wild West as the decades would continue. The growing friendship that Cody had in the business relationship with the Buffalo, New York newspaper man George Bleistein changed the nature of advertising materials being produced for the Wild West. Bleistein was one of the small group of investors in the establishment of Cody, Wyoming, and the posters produced were instrumental in moving forward the advertising. The Cody partners who were working on the city expanded the development of the city and the gateway to Yellowstone, and Bleistein established a stronghold and a lead in advertising for the Wild West for another decade. And his prints were linked to the Courier newspaper, and the large printing presses that were used for the newspaper were also used for these posters. The complexity of the Courier posters was in direct contrast to the earlier art that we saw by Hoehn. And there was an artistic transition from the softer, simpler designs of Hoehn, created in the first decades of the Wild West tours, to that of the more complicated detail. And we saw the military scenes in the prominent posters made from the 1890s all the way up to 1913. But it was in 1899 that Cody accepted an invitation from the artist Rosa Bonheur for a meeting at her chateau during the Paris tour. And she, in turn, was given the freedom to explore the Wild West village and the arena. And she painted Cody on horseback, the Indian performers, the horses, and the buffalo. But it was this representation, and finding this photograph in the Denver Public Library was very exciting to me. This may be the first and only time that an artist's portrayal of an artist is put right into the advertising poster. And there are some other images of Bonheur in the arena with others around her. But this one with the easel painting and the painting that she's working on of Cody is just instrumental in the interaction between the Courier photographers and what's happening with the printed art materials. And then, of course, we see her image used for one of the European posters, and then a rather similar pose in, again, one of the photographs from the Salisbury collection in Denver with Cody on horseback, the scenic backdrop behind, and you'll see some Indians and Cossacks in that photo. And again, trying to think about the analysis of what's being produced photographically and what the graphic artists are doing. But the interaction between Courier and Inquirer is what I have found very fascinating. And thanks to Paul Fees, one of the most exciting moments of my decade journey with the Wild West was being introduced to the original poster artwork that exists at the Circus World Museum. And before my trip, I talked to Paul, and he said, make sure you ask about the Inquirer collection. And I said, why? And he said, because they've got some original artwork. And I said, no, you're telling me that I'm actually going to find what I've been looking for all of these years. The correspondence didn't come through. I didn't find all the contracts or all the business records I found. But what I went when I went to Baraboo, Wisconsin, and was given full access to their storage area and these original pieces, these sketches, the partially painted posters, the watercolors, I was in researcher heaven. And so I have to tell you, I spent only 2 days there, and I hope to go back because, again, as part of putting this material together, as part of the papers project and companion to my dissertation and book, we need to get this all online. And the Ringling Museum and Baraboo, Wisconsin Circus World have collections that equal the centers here, and we need all of this to come together to present the full picture of the visual. So here is one Indian represented in the poster. Again, a generic man, no name for this. It becomes much more stereotypical in designs that Inquirer will do in the last decade of the Wild West. And you see a few of the images of Iron Tail during the Inquirer period, but mostly Redskin warriors are being added. Here we have, you see the drawer that I was able to pull out and open up this five panels of the maze. The maze is used in some other images by as a title for some other posters as well. But you see the mass cavalry, and the exciting part is you can see all the details and the notations from the artists. And these are very, very complicated works. And then sometimes they're partially painted black and white, or sometimes, again, the additional colors like you see there for the flag. But just intensive work needed to make note of all of the intricate details. And here we have two cowgirls, and this is another not very often used poster, but you see in the pencil sketch on the left that they seem to be appearing to ride side saddle. They're in potentially in skirts, and then in the final version, the painted version that will be reproduced for the poster's production, they're riding as men would ride. And also wearing pants. So this experience in Circus World Museum was just phenomenal. And I will work with Jeremy and the crew here to make sure that we move forward with getting this digitized and available for scholars and researchers. So in conclusion, this work that we see, the posters promoted an aesthetic and advertising ethos into everyday life and culture for millions of Americans and Europeans. For 30 years, the Wild West advertising continued to evolve and displayed a flexibility to present a transnational emphasis on selling Cody's vision of America and the West. The art and advertising for Buffalo Bill's Wild West succeeded in branding the American experience at home and abroad, with Cody as a consummate ambassador. As America entered World War I, Cody played his final, before World War I, Cody played his final performances in Denver at the end of the 1916 season. His letters in November 1916 to Lewis Cook noted his interest to continue work and the business in the years to come. But that was not to be. The United States entered the war in April of 17, just 4 months after Cody's death. The advertising for the war effort included the creation of the Division of the Pictorial Publicity to cover and bring designs of 700 posters to the US government departments. These World War I era posters invoke the intersection of the best qualities of art and technology, characteristics displayed and recognized over the 30 years of Buffalo Bill's Wild West advertising. This lasting visual record of Buffalo Bill's Wild West remains a vast resource for study into the specialized art in this era of mass entertainment in America. My research with the William F. Cody papers is dedicated to providing full access to this advertising and print work to scholars and the general public. Thank you.